मैम इज इट विजिबल? Morning to one and all. Today, me and my friends will be sharing a presentation on the first chapter of book Snapshot, The Summer of the Beautiful White Horse, written by William Saroyan. Aryan?
Justification of title, The Summer of the Beautiful White Horse. The chapter is about a childhood incident that the author writes about. He remembers how one early summer morning his cousin Murad brought a beautiful white horse to enjoy riding. Since the incident happened in the summer and the incident was about riding a stolen white horse, the title is perfectly justified.
About the author, William Saroyan. He was born on August 31, 1908. He was an Armenian-American novelist, playwright, and short story writer. He was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for Drama in 1940 and in 1943 won the Academy Award for Best Story for the film The Human Comedy. When the studio rejected his original 240-page treatment, he turned it into a novel, The Human Comedy. Saroyan wrote extensively about the Armenian immigrant life in California. Many of his stories and plays are set in his native Fresno. Some of his best-known works are The Time of Your Life, My Name is Aram and My Heart's in the Highlands. Theme. The theme of the story is about the inevitability of the change that challenges traditions and long established beliefs.
Pardon me?
The Garoglanian tribe was known for its honesty. Although they were poor, they had pride and morals. As when Murad appears at the window in the dawn and Aram sees him with the horse, he tries to refuse that his cousin had stolen with the stolen white horse. Mood of the story. The story is starting with the mood of nostalgia, where Aram remembers his old days. As the story starts with one day back there in the good old days, when I was 9 and the world was full of every imaginable kind of magnificence, and life was still a delightful and mysterious dream. This line tells us that when Aram was 9, he finds everything very delightful and magnificent. It also shows the feeling of desire and longing.
Summary. Aram and Murad were two poor boys who belonged to the Armenian Garoglian family, who were known for their honesty since the 11th century. One early morning when Aram was asleep and was enjoying pleasant dreams, his cousin Murad showed up to his window with a beautiful white horse. Aram could not believe it and was thinking it was a dream. But since there was a little light outside, he knew this for sure, that the horse was real. As they were poverty-stricken, he couldn't believe that the horse was their own. He was trying to figure out if the horse had been stolen by his cousin. Murad had come to invite him for a ride along. He asked him to make it quick before everyone in the world wakes up. Aramir wore his clothes and jumped out of the window and sat behind Maurad on the horse. They rode on the old countryside of the area where they lived, Walnut Avenue. After some time, Maurad asked him to get off as he wanted to ride the horse alone. Aramir asked him if he could also ride the horse alone just like him, to which Maurad said they will see as it was for his own safety. He got to know that Maurad had stolen the horse a month ago and was riding it every morning. When Aramir got his chance of a ride, the horse took him to the vineyard and threw him off and ran away. After searching for 30 minutes, Maurad finally managed to find the horse and they hid him in a deserted vineyard that had some oats and alfalfa. Maurad had a way with everything, especially horses. He knew how to handle every type of animal and also humans. Every morning for 2 weeks, they would take the horse for a ride and then hide it again. One day, John Byrow came to Aram's house to talk to his uncle, Khosrowe, who was an irritated and loud man who shouted at almost everything. Byrow told him about his missing horse, whom he bought at $60. For 1 month, he couldn't find it and he walked for 10 miles to come to their house. Khosrowe roared at him and told him it's no harm. Paid no attention to it. Byrow became irritated by his attitude and he went away. Aram went to Maurad and told him about the missing horse of Byrow and asked him not to return the horse until he learns to ride it. Maurad told him that it would take 1 year for him to learn to ride the horse. He further angrily added that they could not be thieves as their tribe is known for honesty, and said that they would return the horse after 6 months.
One day on their way back to hide the horse to the hidden spot, they met John Byrow, who was going back to the town. He talked to them and carefully examined the horse. He admitted that the horse looked exactly like the one he had, but since he knew his parents and the honesty of their family, he didn't believe that they had his missing horse. He assumed that it was a twin horse. Murad managed to let Byrow assume that it was not his horse, so they went away. The next morning, both of them took the horse back to Byrow's vineyard and put it in the barn. The dogs followed them all along quietly and they left the place. The same afternoon, John Byrow came back to his house to tell his mother about his horse who had come back. He was happy and was astonished to see the horse better temper and it was stronger than ever. Uncle Khosrow again rode, "Quiet man, quiet. Your horse has been returned. Pay no attention to it."
Analysis. First point, justification with faulty logics. Aram knows that Murad stole the horse, but Aram lets his desire to ride the horse override his reasons. He makes justifications with faulty logics for why this wasn't technically stealing. In other words, the boys were trying to find a way to fulfill their desire while protecting the honest reputation of their family. Such as, Aram believes that the act will be stealing if they sell the horse for money, while Murad thinks that keeping the horse for 1 year is stealing, but keeping it for 6 months is acceptable. Relying on feelings as opposed to reasons. Despite Murad being referred as crazy, Aram admires his older cousin, which is further seen in the story when Murad draws Aram into his reliance on feelings instead of rationality, just by saying, "I have a way with animals." Ambitions. We have seen the cousins didn't came from a wealthy family, rather belonged to a life of extreme poverty. Despite these situations, the boys had a strong desire to ride a horse, especially Aram. Ending. There can be two deciding paths for the ending of the story. First scenario being trust of John Byro, that despite checking the horse's tooth, John refused to accept that the people of the Garoglanian family would do such thing and convinced himself that the horse in front of him was a possible twin. The boys felt guilty when Byro expressed his faith in them and returned the horse. The second case being the forgiveness of Byro. He recognized his horse and knew where his horse was in the past month, but he neither complained to their parents nor hinted the boys of their theft being caught. Instead, gives them the opportunity to make the decision themselves. The boys ultimately prove the Garoglanian honesty to be true and return the horse. This brings us to the end of the presentation. This presentation was made by Vanshika Shah, Aryan Sinha and Arvind Sharma. Thank you.
Very good. Very, very good. In fact, both of you. In fact, three of you, all three of you. Very, very good. Arav, you can, you can stop the recording now. Okay, very good. Anybody?
Love, care, respect, courage, and warmth. She not only brought us into this world, but also nurtured us with her selfless love and care. Without caring for her own needs and happiness, a mother works tirelessly as a caregiver, teacher, mentor, friend, and role model. She is the thread that binds the entire family together. A mother is the emotional backbone of a family. She prepares us to face the world with confidence and dignity. However, we sometimes fail to recognize and acknowledge our mother's contribution to our lives. Every mom deserves much appreciation and gratitude for countless reasons. The best thing about a picture is that it never changes, even when the people in it do.
A photograph shows how time takes its toll on life. We try to capture moments from life which remain as pictures in our mind, faint, some clear. What is finally left is the silence and death for the next generation to reflect upon. The title, A Photograph, is a symbolic of such pleasurable moments in life which leave an indelible imprint on our mind. And past memories keep flashing back into our mind when we look at the photograph years later. Change is the harsh and bitter reality of life. Time and tide wait for none. Death comes as the greatest leveler. It is the inevitable end of all. Objects of nature like the sea, the river, the brooks, and the oceans are perennial and everlasting. But human life is too short in comparison. When death strikes, we humans are expected to accept the loneliness, the vacuum it creates. Despite the fact that it focuses on speakers, everyone has experienced loss of some kind. In the lines of this poem, Tolson, one of the most interesting elements of this,
I think for the mother, is a disturbance.
Also,
Lakshya, you can play it again later.
A few for future life.
Remembering her mother, poet looks at the photo frame, which pleasantly expresses the mother's sweet childhood memories when she, along with her cousins, went paddling. Poet's mother was 12 years old and was the eldest among her cousins. All three of them sit still, holding their hands, posing in front of their uncle, who was capturing this cheerful moment in his camera. Poet says that her mother had a sweet face when she was young, even before when Poet was born. She also said that her mother has changed through the years, but the sea remained the same, as change is transient and is inevitable. But only weed and rock could resist life, and the sea lies in the same category.
After 23 years, her mother would laugh at the photograph. She would make the poet look at the photograph and tell her how their parents would dress them up for the beach holidays. Was her mother's favorite past memories, and her laugh was the poet's favorite memory. Both of them lost something which they cherished a lot and yet cannot live with that moment again. Those sweet moments were memories now.
Now, it's been 12 years since her mother died, and on such sorrowful occasion, the poet finds herself speechless. It's silence silences, which means that the poet is in pain. She is helpless and cannot do anything for her mother's death.
Allusion. Allusion is an incidental mention of something. An example of allusion in this poem is cardboard, which actually refers to the photograph. Alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of the initial letter, generally a consonant. Example of alliteration in this poem are still, still to smile, terribly transient, its silence silences. Transferred epithet. Transferred epithet is a description that refers to a character or event, but it is used to describe a different situation or character. Transient feet is an example of the transferred epithet in this poem. It refers to human feel, but it is used to describe the lack of permanence of human life. Oxymoron. In this literary device, two opposite ideas are joined to create an effect. Labored ease in the poem is an example of an oxymoron. Both words have opposite meanings, but they are clubbed together. Personification. Example is its silence silences. Situation has been given the human quality of silence. Cynic dog. Feet in the poem is an example of cynic dog. Feet here represent the growing up of mother.
We end up with a quote. Nostalgia is a crossroad down memory lane. It either makes your eyes shine or brings forth a tornado of emotions.
Excellent. In fact, when did you do the recording? Like, how did you manage all three of you together?
Ma'am, we edited.
Okay, you edited. That's good. That's good. So, what were the contributions? Like all three of you, what were your individual contributions in it?
Ma'am, Akansha did the intro and bit of the explaining part. Lakshya did the theme and the poetic devices. I compiled all the videos, and I also explained a paragraph, first stanza and third stanza.
Excellent, excellent. This was very nice. In fact, a beautiful virtual tour kind of thing. So, really liked it. Really, really liked it. Yeah, in fact, this is a very effective medium also. Audio visual together, it's really very effective. In fact, in between, there was maybe my end, there might have been network issues or whatever. Some parts I could not hear them properly. So, maybe you can send it across on the group. I can again play it, and I'll share this with every other class. I'll share it with the other teacher who teaches, even with Garima ma'am. That was really nice. In fact, Arav and all, your PPT as well, I'll share it with the teachers as well. That was really nice, very good. So you all, in fact, the effort shows, that's what I'm saying. And you know what, when you, at least six of you, when you have done in two particular chapters, trust me, you remember it better. Somebody doing it for you and you doing it yourself has a lot of difference. And you'll notice that when you are doing it in your exam as well. You are now very clear about the theme, mood and everything when it goes to poetry. Even if in the chapter, even if I haven't taught it yet. But the understanding, the grasp, the way Arav has done the analysis. In fact, Arav, I wanted to know what was each one of your contributions in that, individual contributions. Like, what all did you do? Okay. Okay. Excellent, excellent. So Aryan, you and Vanshika, kudos to you, beta. Very good, very nice. I am really happy. So for each one of you, this is from me, and keep continuing this good work. Yeah, great. So on that note, we have covered two things together. One is your photograph, which I, as for me, is closed. Any question that you have, individually also you can ask me, in the class also we can discuss. The question answer, I would expect that you do it. No more of that spoon feeding that I tell you the answers, dictate you and all that. Even if that, but I have sent you the PPTs and all, you can refer to that. I will send you further content as well, and you can make use of it. Now today we are going to just enough time to read the chapter, that is the Summer of the Beautiful White Horse. But before we start, you and Vanshika have given you that background, but a little more addition, just a little more. You can always remember what they have talked about, but the chapter is based in a place called Armenia. So we must know where is Armenia and what is it. Do the reading of the chapter, Vita? Any one of you can just tell me. Did we complete reading the chapter or we didn't?
Ma'am, you asked Tanak, to make the PPT about? before we read the chapter.
Very good. So before we read the chapter, let me just brief you about, there are a few things you must know. One is Armenia. Have you heard of this place ever? Geography. Question of geography. Where is Armenia? Can anybody tell me?
Ma'am, near Russia.
Okay. Somebody said near Russia. Who was that? I just couldn't notice that. Yeah, who said Russia?
Gautam.
Okay, Gautam. Yes, you are very right. It is near, in fact, it was a part of the previous USSR. Do you know the yes, Union of Soviet Socialist Republic. It was earlier there, and nowadays it's called Russia. Like they're divided, in fact, disintegrated, and a part of it is Russia, and the rest is called the CIS country. So this right now, Armenia is a part of that disintegrated whole, that whatever was there. And it is very close to a place called Azerbaijan, if you have heard the name. So these two countries, they have been at loggerheads. They have been fighting a ethnic war kind of thing. Read about it a little bit. Yes, it will help you understand. Yes.
Ma'am, it is so for a region, Karabakh.
Yes, very good, Gautam.
And they had a war last year only.
Yes, yes, yes. Karabakh is the main bone of contention between both of them. So Armenia is a part. And in fact, why I'm talking about that? Because you have to know the climate. You have to know about a little bit of the landscape, the area, the people, the cuisine, everything before we start the chapter. And Armenia's capital is, any idea, Gautam? What is the capital of Armenia?
No, ma'am.
Okay, but you know quite a bit.
Ma'am, I know the capital of Azerbaijan, it's Baku.
Yes, Baku.
Ma'am, Yerevan, Armenia.
Yerevan, yes, yeah. Excellent. So Yerevan is what we are talking about here. Very nice. I am so happy. At least you guys are aware and that really helped. Okay. So talking about Armenia, the weather is more or less cold always. So that is why the chapter is called the Summer of the Beautiful White Horse. We come back to the chapter's title as well. Before we do all the, we complete first the small things, small details, and then we move to the chapter. So like I said, Armenia has a very cold climate and a very brief period of time. They have you can say summer or rather spring. And that is the time which people think is very good. And this is what we are talking about in this chapter as well. And this particular thing, now coming back to the title of the chapter, the Summer of the Beautiful White Horse. If I divide those every word individually, what do you mean by that? Why is the title given so, that the Summer of the Beautiful White Horse? Can anybody tell me? Why this title? In fact, I've answered the question already. If you would have heard me right, maybe it will be easy for you to understand. Can anybody tell me? Why is it called the summer of the beautiful white horse? Okay, the summer is beautiful here and the color of the horse is white. In fact, what are the white horses generally called? Any idea? The imaginary ones, the mythological ones.
Pegasus.
Yes.
Unicorn.
Pegasus.
Ah, in fact, all of you know. That's really good. So, we talk about... Sashwat, what was it? I didn't hear.
Pegasus have wings.
Yes, wings and one horn here. The single horn. Yeah.
Ma'am, those are different. Those are unicorns.
Wings. Yes. So, both the things you can... In fact, here you can run your imagination, Roy. Completely. You can just think of both the things together. In fact, who wouldn't like to see either of them? At least I would love to see both of them, in fact. So that is what is the talk here. It's basically telling you that the child's world is not very, at times, not very real. They don't talk about practical things. They talk about dreams. They talk about imagination. Not today's kid. Today's kid, I am too sorry to say that. You guys are very, very practical. You know what you want in life and all. Maybe my time also, I can say that I was not very clear what exactly I wanted. And always lived in my own dream world, thinking of those phantoms and He-Man and all that. I'm sure these days also, it's like they are into that anime or something like that. That's what my son says, anime. And cartoon characters are not out yet.
So, anime.
Anime, yes. I keep in track of all this because of that one son of mine who's into all this. Okay. Now, talking about that, so this is an imaginary world of a child who doesn't want to, rise up, doesn't want to be awake. He wants to live in his dream. He wants to think of beautiful life, which is not there. In fact, Arav has so beautifully summed up that chapter. I'm so happy that way, that my task is so easy now. Now, this child, these two children, in fact, Aaron and Murad, they are dreamers. They want some good things in life, but then life isn't the same. It is. It talks about the poor Armenian kids. When you read about them, then coming to terms with the fact that, this tribe is known for their honesty and integrity, and then stealing something. So justifying their act, how it moves, all this thing is about this chapter. In fact, if we begin like this, this story is has in fact got autobiographical elements. Autobiography, I'm sure you all know, written by self, about the self stories and all that. So it is the autobiography or the autobiographical elements William Saran has tried to put in this story. He is also Armenian. He's grown up in that part of the country. So the attachment to that place, little secrets of your growing up. In fact, each one of us have. We have beautiful memories. We have nostalgia when we think of it. We really have memories which are so pleasant, and we want to cherish them forever. This chapter again is just that. In fact, let me share the chapter with you. If you have your own book, you can always look into it, or else I'm just sharing the PDF. All we have time for is maximum, maybe we can complete the reading. Just a second. Do you have your books? You can read it. Aishwarya, why don't you better read the chapter, the first two pages of the chapter aloud for the class? Aishwarya, are you there, better?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please read the first two pages. First one is small, so you can read the next page as well.
Okay, ma'am. One day back there, in the good old days, when I was 9 and the world was full of every imaginable kind of magnificence, and life was still a delightful and mysterious dream, my cousin Murad who was considered crazy by everybody, who knew him except me, came to my house at 4 in the morning and woke me up tapping on the window of my room. "Aram," he said. I jumped out of the bed and looked out of the window. I could not believe what I saw. It wasn't morning yet, but it was summer, and with daybreak, not many minutes around the corner of the world, it was light enough for me to know I wasn't dreaming. My cousin Murad was sitting on a beautiful white horse. I stuck my head out of the window and rubbed my eyes. "Yes," he said in Armenian, "it's a horse. You're not dreaming. Make it quick if you want to write." Ma'am, could you scroll down?
Invisible?
Yes, ma'am. I knew my cousin Murad enjoyed being alive more than anybody else who had ever fallen into the world by mistake. But this was more than I could believe. In the first place, my earliest memories had been memories of horses, and my first longings had been longings to ride. This was the wonderful part. In the second place, we were poor. This was the part that wouldn't permit me to believe what I saw. We were poor. We had no money. Our whole tribe was poverty stricken. Every branch of the Garogluhanian family was living in the most amazing and comical poverty in the world. Nobody with food in our bellies. Could understand where we got, where we ever got our money enough to keep us with food in our bellies. Not even the old men of our honesty. We had been famous for our honesty for something like 11 centuries, even when we... Yes, ma'am?
You're skipping one line each. It is like old men of the family, most important of all.
Most important of all, though we were famous for our honesty, we had been famous for our honesty for something like even for 11 centuries, even when we had been the wealthiest family in what we like to think was the world. We were proud first, honest next. And after that, we believed in right and wrong. None of us would take advantage of anybody in the world, let alone steal. Consequently, even though I could see the horse so magnificent, even though I could smell it so lovely, even though I could hear it breathing so exciting, I couldn't believe the horse had anything to do with my cousin Murad, or with me, or with any of the other members of our family, asleep or awake, because I knew my cousin Murad couldn't have bought the horse, and if he couldn't have bought it, it must have been stolen. And I refused to believe he had stolen it. No member of the family could have been a thief. I stared first at my cousin and then at the horse. There was a pious stillness and humor in each of them, which on the one hand delighted me, on the other frightened me. "Murad," I said, "where did you steal this horse?" "Leap out of the window," he said, "if you want to ride." It was true then. He had stolen the horse. There was no question about it. He had come to invite me to ride or not, as I chose. Well, it seemed to me stealing a horse for a ride was not the same thing as stealing something else, such as money. For all I knew, maybe it wasn't stealing at all. If you were crazy about horses the way my cousin Murad and I were, it wasn't stealing. It wouldn't become stealing until we offered to sell the horse, which of course I knew we would never do.
That's it. Now, Siddharth, if you can read from here again.
Yes, ma'am. "Let me put on some clothes," I said. "All right," he said, "but hurry." I leaped into my clothes. I jumped down the yard from the window and leaned up onto the horse behind my cousin Murad. That year, we lived at the edge of town on Walnut Avenue. Behind our house was the country. Vineyards, orchards, irrigation, orchards, irrigation ditches, and country roads. In less than 3 minutes, we were on the Olive Avenue, and then the horse began to trot. The air was new and lovely to breathe. The feel of the horse running was wonderful. My cousin Murad was considered one of the craziest members of our family, began to sing. I mean, he began to roar. Every family has a crazy streak in it somewhere, and my cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of the crazy streaks in our tribe. Before him was our uncle
Khosrow,
an anonymous man with a powerful head of black hair and the largest mustache in San Joaquin Valley. A man so furious in temper, so irritable, so impatient that he stopped anyone from talking by roaring. It's no harm. Pay no attention to it. That was all. No matter what anybody happened to be talking about. Once it was his own son, Eric, running 8 blocks to the barber shop where his father was having his mustache trimmed to tell him their house was on fire. This man, Khosrow, sat up in the chair and roared, "It is no harm. Pay no attention to it." The barber said, "But the boy says your house is on fire." So Khosrow roared, "Enough. It is no harm, I say." My cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of this man, although Murad's father was Zurab, who was practically and nothing else.
Practical.
Practical and nothing else. That's how it was in our tribe. A man could be the father of his son's flesh, but that did not mean that he was also the father of his spirit. The distribution of the various kinds of spirit in our tribe has been from the beginning
capricious
and vagrant. We rode and my cousin Murad sang. For all anybody knew, we were still in the old country where, at least according to some of our neighbors, we belonged. We let the horse run as long as it felt like running. At last, my cousin Murad said, "Get down, I want to ride alone." "Will you let me ride alone?" I asked. "That is up to the horse," my cousin said. "Get down." "The horse will let me ride," I said. "We shall see," he said. "Don't forget that I have way with the horse." "Well," I said, "any way you have with the horse, I have also." "For the sake of her safety," he said, "let us hope so. Get down." "All right," I said, "but remember, you have got to let me try to ride alone." I got down and my cousin Murad kicked his heel into the horse and shouted,
Wazir,
run. The horse stood up on its hind legs, snorted, and burst into fury of speed. That was the loveliest thing I had ever seen.
Maybe Gautam, you can read this page, my cousin Murad. Either of the Gautams, both of you, Gautam Kumar or Gautam Kakkad, anybody can read. Fast. Are you there or you left? Yeah. And after you, then they can read.
Okay, ma'am. My cousin Murad raced the horse across a field of dry grass to an irrigation ditch, crossed the ditch on the horse, and 5 minutes later returned dripping wet. "The sun was coming up. Now it's my turn to ride," I said. My cousin Murad got off the horse. "Ride," he said. I leaped to the back of the horse and for a moment knew the most awful fear imaginable. The horse did not move. "Kick into his muscles," my cousin Murad said. "What are you waiting for? We've got to take him back before everybody in the world is up and about." I kicked into the muscles of the horse once again and snorted. Then it began to run. I didn't know what to do. Instead of running across the field to the irrigation ditch, the horse ran down the road to the vineyard of Dikran Halabian, where it began to leap over vines. The horse leaped over 7 vines before I fell. Then it continued running. My cousin Murad came running down the road. I'm not worried about you, he shouted. We've got to get that horse back. You go this way and I'll go this way. If you come upon him, be kindly. I'll be near. I continued down the road and my cousin Murad went across the field towards the irrigation ditch. It took him half an hour to find the horse and bring him back. All right, he said, jump on. The whole world is awake now. What will we do? I said. He said, we'll either take him back or hide him until tomorrow morning. He didn't sound worried. And I knew he'd hide him and not take him back. Not for a while, at any rate. Where will we hide him? I said. I know a place, he said. How long ago did you steal the horse? I said. It suddenly dawned on me that he had been taking these early morning rides for some time and had come for me this morning only because he knew how much I longed to ride. Who said anything about stealing a horse? He said. Anyhow, I said, how long did you begin riding every morning?
Yeah, that's it. Are you there, Gautam? Are you there, beta? Say yes or no.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, read this page.
From the starting?
Not until this morning. From here, page number
not 6. Not until this morning, he said. Are you telling the truth? I said, of course not, he said. But if we are found out, that's what you are to say. I don't want both of us to be liars. All you know is that we started riding this morning. All right, I said. He walked the horse quietly to the barn of deserted vineyard, which at one time had been the pride of a farmer named
John
Petwajian. There were some oats and dry alfalfa in the
alfalfa
in the barn. We began walking home. It wasn't easy, he said, to get the horse to behave so nicely. At first, I wanted to run wild, but as I've told you, I have a way with the horse. I can get it to
Anything wrong?
Ma'am, I'm having a bad throat right
okay.
now.
Okay. No issue. Maybe Arav, you just continue from here, beta. Then I'll ask somebody else. Yeah, it wasn't easy, he said. Wanted to do. I can get it to want to do anything I want it to do. Koshro.
Now maybe Akanksha, are you there, beta?
Ma'am, I wanted to ask you something. Ma'am, what is the meaning of sari?
Beta, it's a carrier. Actually, something which is attached to the horse. There is a carriage kind of a thing. That is called a sari. Yeah. Maybe Akanksha, are you there, beta? Can you read and complete the chapter? And then we wind up the class.
That horse calls me Chiroyal, the farmer said. I spit on money, my uncle, for services. He got up and stalked out of the house, slamming the screen door. My mother explained, he has a gentle heart, he said. But simply that he's homesick and with a large man. The farmer went away and I ran over to my cousin Murad's house. He was sitting under a peach tree, trying to repair the heart pain, heart pain, yellow robin, which could not cry. He was talking to the bird. What it is?
What happened? There is a problem with the network.
He visited our house. He wants his horse. He has had. My voice audible?
Yeah, now it is audible.
It will take you a year to learn to ride, my cousin Murad said. We could keep the horse a year since. My cousin Murad left to his feet. What? He rode. Are you inviting a member of the Harugaranian family to see you? The horse must go back to its true owner. When? I said. In 6 months, at the latest, he said. He threw the bird into the air. The bird tried hard, almost fell twice. But at last, three away, I am free. Early every morning, for 2 weeks, my cousin Murad and I took the horse out of the barn of the deserted vineyard. We were hiding it and rode it. And every morning, my leapt over the grapevines and small trees and threw me an animal. Nevertheless, hope in this time to learn to ride the way my cousin Murad did. One morning on the way to Petwajian Desert Vineyard, we ran into the farmer, John Byro, who was on his way to town. Let me do the talking, my cousin Murad said. I have a way to farmers. Good morning, John Byro, my cousin Murad said to the farmer. The farmer steadies the horse again. Good morning, son of my friends, he said. What is the name of your horse? My heart, my cousin Murad said.
Yeah, I'll just your voice is getting disrupted, so I'll just complete it fast so that your class is almost done. Okay. My heart, my cousin Murad said in Armenian, a lovely name, John Byro said, for a lovely horse. I could swear it is the horse that was stolen from me many weeks ago. May I look into his mouth? Of course, Murad said. The farmer looked into the mouth of the horse. Tooth for tooth, he said. I would swear it is my horse if I didn't know your parents, the fame of your family for honesty is well known to me. Yet the horse is the twin of my horse. A suspicious man would believe his eyes instead of his heart. Good day, my young friends. Good day, John Byro, my cousin Murad said. Early the following morning, we took the horse to John Byro's farm, vineyard, and put it in the barn. The dogs followed as around without making a sound. The dogs, I whispered to my cousin Murad, I thought they would bark. They would at somebody else, he said. I have a rabid dog. My cousin Murad put his arms around the horse, pressed his nose to the horse's mouth, patted it, and then we went away. That afternoon, John Byro came to our house in his surrey and showed my mother the horse that had been stolen and returned. I do not know what to think, he said. The horse is stronger than ever. better tempered too. I thank God my uncle Kushto, who was in the parlor, became irritated and shouted, "Quiet, man, quiet. Your horse has been returned. Pay no attention to it." So this is the chapter all about. Next class when we meet, we are going to definitely do the discussion. And for today, let's wind up the class. Thank you so much. And thank you, Arav, and your group. And thank you to the other group as well. And that wonderful presentation. So keep it up.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. All of you, have a good day.
Thank you, ma'am.